Welcome again. This brings us to the last session on CME in Gynae Obstetrics practical examination. You heard about long cases, short cases, and lastly we come to another important element, that is ward round and viva. Dr. Kamala Ganesh, who has been Director Professor, Maulanazad Medical College, and also a very frequent examiner for the National Board candidates. Lot of experience behind her as far as examinations are concerned. Listen to her carefully. She'll talk about ward rounds and viva and other important issues with regard to practical in your subject. Before we start that, I'll once again quickly remind you that the program that was scheduled for 20th has been shifted to 22nd of this month. Morning session for anesthesia, afternoon session for students in pediatrics, which was to be held on 20th. Kindly inform your friends and ask them to look up the website in order to see this program. We begin with Gynae Obs again and Dr. Ganesh now.
Hello, good afternoon to all of you. Now, we will discuss now the ward round and the viva was seen in obstetrics and gynae viva, including the spots. Now, ward round, the time allocated is 10 minutes. I have seen it is conducted in two ways. That is, one way is the candidate is allotted a post-operative case or a postnatal case in the ward, a obstetric operated case or a gynae operated case. The junior doctor accompanies her and gives her some information. Now the candidate is to ask for more information from the junior doctor. The patient, if both of them doesn't give, even the examiner gives her more information. Now here it is very important, this is how you conduct yourself. You have to ask relevant questions. If you are asking so many questions which are not relevant to your case at all, you don't get time to discuss your case. So the relevant information is to be asked for from the junior doctor, patient and the examiner. Now next, examines the patient and the baby if it is a postnatal case, and she discusses with the examiners. Now the other way is, candidate is allotted a post-operative case, the junior doctor doesn't accompany her. She gets information from the patient or the relations, examine patients and the baby, ask for more information if required, if the patient could not give, from the examiners, and the discussion with the examiners about the case. Next. Now, what are the information you should elicit? The date of operation, age, parity, medical problems. If date is not given, the day, the second day of post-operative, first day post-operative, like that. The name of the operation and indication. If it is the patient giving you information, she'll tell you bachchadani nikal diya. She may not be able to give you an associated salpingophorectomy and all, which you can ask from the examiner himself. Indication, anesthesia, smooth or problems, blood transfusion, if it was given or not, any technical difficulty during surgery, any problem in the recovery, post-operative room on the day of operation. Now, ensure if drugs, if taken for medical diseases, are continued or not. Check chart, patient's has a chart at the bottom of the cot, so check for temperature, the daily intake output and also the drugs given, and then examine the patient for pulse, pallor, hydration. Note breathing. If it is normal, it's fine. Otherwise, count the respiratory rate, the blood pressure, chest auscultate, abdomen, look for tenderness, softness, rigidity, mass, wound soakage, drainage tube present or not, bowel sound, or any other findings if you can elicit. Now look at the vulva, if there is a catheter present or not. vaginal bleeding is there, or discharge, the type of discharge. Now, then the discussion comes. Now, the discussion, whatever I say, it comes in one form or the other from the things that you have answered, the findings you have given. So, usually, instructions, what are the instructions given after operation? How much fluid to be given? What sort of antibiotics you give? So, your hospital practice you can give, or you can say, even if my hospital practices this, for these reasons, I would like to give this antibiotic. It's quite all right. So you have to justify again the antibiotic therapy that you give. Type of wound, whether it is clean, potentially septic or septic wounds, this comes in the discussion. Then the complications, the early diagnosis, how will you make an early diagnosis? What investigations you will do for the complications and diagnosis? Complication diagnosis and how will you manage each complication is very important. Now, how you exactly do in your situation is will quite suffice. Say, in my institution, this is what I do, is fine. But don't give things which are not manageable. For example, if there is a secondary hemorrhage after hysterectomy, you are not going to examine the patient in the ward or in the bed. The patient has to be taken to a theater. The anesthetist should be available, blood should be available in things. But suppose a patient is bleeding in the ward, very little bleeding, you can tell, I'll change the antibiotic, I'll wait and see. So after 2 or 3 hours, I'll go back and see her whether the bleeding has increased. So all sorts of answers that you give should be appropriate, applicable and manageable. So you can give any answers that are practiced in your institution, it is welcome. The next. Now the questions in the viva, this is ward round, you are allotted 10 minutes and the marks given is out of 40. The dummy doll, bony pelvis and fetal skull are in the obstetrics and gynae viva. Bony pelvis and fetal skull. In the pelvis and in the fetal skull, you are asked to demarcate the landmarks. Show me the point, occiput. Show me the pectoral eminences, sacroiliac joints, the diameters. So you should be able to show the landmarks, say about the diameters, and then you are asked, say in this thing, when you say vertex presentation, what is the area in this fetal skull that you mean? So you have to show the boundary of the fetal skull in various presentations. Then the fetal skull is asked to be put in various presentations and positions, like occipital posterior position, anterior face presentation, mento anterior, like that. You are asked to keep the fetal skull in the pelvis in various presentation and positions. And so this is in that, and also during, you know, what level, if the fetus is in the, at the level of the brim, below the brim, at the level of the ischial spine, where it will be. So you should be able to show that, all that in the fetal pelvis and the maternal pelvis and the fetal skull. Now, dummy and doll are kept and you are asked for demonstration. Demonstration is on mechanism of labor, conducting a normal delivery, a forceps and vacuum delivery, the breech, face, the bra, the cesarean section, how do you deliver the baby in a transverse lie, in a breech. Now with each one, the problem that can arise in the normal conducting the delivery, a postpartum hemorrhage, all that will come here. Each one follows the what you are shown, what you are asked. Forceps and vacuum delivery, the indication, what advantage it has over the other. So everything follows by showing you a forceps, asking you to deliver in a dummy doll, and they are supposed after delivery there is a hemorrhage, how will you manage that? This thing. So dummy and doll can lead you to asking questions on any presentation, position, the instrumental delivery, the cesarean delivery, all those will be included in this. Then comes the obstetric instruments. You are shown, the following things are kept, and in the instruments, they are asked the questions. Episiotomy scissors are shown. So how will you do an episiotomy? What muscles are cut? How will you suture the episiotomy? How will you do a postoperative care? Perineal tears, various perineal tears, how will you manage? In the perineal tear, a third degree perineal tear, how will you manage immediately? Later on, if the wound breaks, what will you do? So all those things, one should be able to give the logical answer to that question. Then Cocker's forceps is shown, and different methods of induction of labor, surgical as well as medical, it can lead to. In the surgical induction, low rupture of membranes. Before you do that, they will ask you ripening the cervix. So you have to say the methods of ripening the cervix, like dinoprostol gel, these days some of them use misoprostol. You must give the advantage and disadvantage of each. What will happen if excessive dose is given, or if the dinoprostol gel goes inside the uterus instead of the cervix, instead of intracervical, it becomes intrauterine application. What will happen? So those questions are led from showing the Cocker's forceps or a dinoprostol gel or this thing, which will come, we will come later on. Then long needles are kept. The paracervical block, pudendal block. Now you must say conditions where you need to use a pudendal block, where you need to use a paracervical block, how will you do it, what are the complications, and indications when you have to give these blocks. So the needles lead you to those questions. Then sponge holding forceps are shown. You are asked the use of these. From it can lead to visualization of the cervix, managing PPH. So it can start with the managing PPH. Then how to differentiate between atonic and traumatic PPH. How will you manage each? How will you visualize the cervix? What will you do if the cervical tear is extended into the vault? So the questions leads on laparotomy. How will you repair that at laparotomy? Then if there is a cesarean, what all instruments? So you are using sponge holding forceps is one of that to hold the edge when denormitage forceps is not available. So that becomes important. Now people show Allis forceps often to hold the edge of the cesarean wound, which is not accepted by many examiners because they say Allis forceps is to hold the soft tissues. It is not a clamp. Hemostatic clamp has to be used. So if there is a hemorrhage, the Allis forceps, the sponge holding forceps or denormitage clamp has to be used. If you are just holding the edge without hemorrhage, even then Allis forceps is a very delicate forceps. Thick things cannot be used. Some in the hospitals have got long Allis forceps, 8 inches long and all, which is meant for using in cesarean. That can be used. So you have to justify. If you show a 4.5-5 inches of Allis forceps and you say that this is for hemostatic clamp in cesarean, people will not accept that, because that, for one thing, it is not in this hemostatic clamp. It doesn't stop the hemorrhage. And the second thing is the thick uterine wall cannot be held with a very delicate forceps. It has to be a strong forceps. So it comes to that. Then denormitage clamp itself can be given. Delivering the cesarean section, how it is done, and managing problems during cesarean. Various steps, various problems at various steps in a cesarean, in a previous cesarean, repeat cesarean, the scar, where to give the incision, how do you know it is the lower segment? All these questions, when the denormitage clamp is given and the questions are asked. Then Carman's cannula. Besides MTP, you also do suction evacuation for hydratiform mold, evacuation of products of conception in inevitable and incomplete abortions. So Carman's cannula also is asked besides MTP. For these indications, you have to tell them. Then the family planning. That is another thing which is asked from each student is asked about one or the other family planning methods. Now, intrauterine devices, copper T is there, multi-load is there. So they ask you what is the copper tea available now, because copper tea 380A is available now, not to copper tea 200. So one should be aware of that, what was used before, why it has been changed, what is the advantage of it now. So you should be able to answer all those questions. The various side effects immediately, the later on, late side effects, the complications, and each complications, how are you going to manage, and how are you going to diagnose and manage. So you should be able to answer that. Then falloperidol is shown, Babcock forceps is shown. That is for sterilization. Falloperidol, when it is given to you, they take you to laparoscopic sterilization, different methods. Now when they show Babcock forceps, then the questions are asked, how many types of tubectomy you know, that postpartum, the mini laparotomy, the interval sterilization, how will you do, what method you are following, what is the difference between Pomeroy and modified Pomeroy, all that questions are asked and you should be able to answer those questions. Then various types of oral pills are shown to you. Some are monophasic, triphasic pill, the different combinations are being used. So the types of packets are kept, you are asked to pick up one and ask questions on oral pills. Then injectables and implants. So advantage, disadvantage, side effect, one over the other. Where will you use pills? When will you give injections? Condom, diaphragm, cervical cap, as a this thing are shown to you, and you are female condom. Today, spermicidal jelly are kept in the on the table, and you are asked questions on. Now, gynae instruments. Drugs are the one. Yes, you can ask questions.
Use a mic, please.
Some candidate wants to ask some questions, so.
What are the modifications in second trimester abortion?
See, nowadays, ithacridine lactate is used commonly, but many are using misoprostol now to produce a second trimester abortion. But it has not come into being. I suggest that there are national guidelines for MTP procedure, that is suction evacuation and MVA, manual vacuum aspiration. The national guidelines for oral pills, sterilization, IUD insertion, these are available. You should be able to, because in your practice also, this is going to be more useful. See, what we should follow in our country, it is spelled out very clearly, very nicely. So you should get these national guidelines and go through it.
Where do they get it from?
You are getting it from the ministry, but if you are not able to get it from the from them, you can get it. This IGNU has a program called PGDMCH, PG Diploma in Maternal and Child Health. It gives, one book is only on family planning. It gives on everything that is in the national guidelines in these books. You can get it. You go outside this room, you the shops will give you. But I don't know whether you have to buy more books to get this one, or this book alone will be supplied to you. You have to find out that about yourself.
One more question. Do we require dilatation for MVA?
See, dilatation is required, but the dilatation is not done with the dilators. The dilatation is done in increasing caliber of the dilators, Carman's cannula, which is attached with the syringe. So you start with the 4-number cannula, dilate it, then 5-number cannula, 6-number cannula, like that. So the dilatation is accomplished not with the metal dilator, but by the cannula itself. So there is a set of 7 or 8 cannulas given in with the MVA syringe. So each one you have to use, yes. You know that MVA can be used by the health, these ANMs and the LHVs also. They are also, they don't do MTPs, but MVAs are used for doing, completing the evacuation with incomplete abortion and inevitable.
I know that
so some of the people are being taught now how to use MVA. by these people.
For ANMs, and they are allowed to use it.
They are being taught now in the RCH. Come to that. My next slide also shows, because there are some things which ANM are being entrusted with in the RCH too. So we will come to that later.
And one more thing, madam, I want to clarify for Alice. What is the final answer? Should we use in cesarean section or not?
See, if it is you are using for controlling the bleeding, it is wrong. If you are holding it to hold the edge, yes.
Yes, for holding.
But it will not control the bleeding.
Oh, our answer should be that.
Yes, because in cesarean section, the wound is going to bleed.
Yeah.
Some place or the other.
Yes, because it is open.
Exactly. Yes. In those places, Dean Armitage clamp or spondyling forceps has to be used.
The Ellis forceps is very small and it has sharp edges.
Unless it is designed, as I told you, it is designed to hold this thing, some 8 inches long.
No, Ellis as a postgraduate, I want to know what should be our answer.
No, it should be for tough tissues only, Ellis forceps. But for cesarean wounds, sponge holder for the angles.
Now, drug, next slide.
Edges, sir. Thank you.
The next thing, drugs are kept on both tables, the gynae table as well as the obstetric table. So usually the things which are used with the obstetrics are kept in the obstetric table, but sometimes they mix it also. Gynae drugs should be kept on table and the obstetric drugs should be kept at the obstetric table. Now, uterotonic or those drugs which cause uterine contraction, enhances the uterine contractions, like syntocinon, methergine, prostidine, misoprostol are kept in the obstetric table. Now, each one, when you get the drug, you should know the dosage in the condition in which it is used, the dosage in which it is used, the parenteral route, as Dr. Ashok already said, the route of administration. Are you going to give an IV? Are you going to give an IM? IV means drip in one dose. So drip means how much you want in the drip and how many drops per minute. So all those, and in how many hours you will finish the drip, one bottle. So all these things should be clear. Then drugs used for preterm labor are kept on the table. Uterine relaxants like dubedilon, utopa, rotavirine. There are others, many others like nifedipine, the skin patch, whichever is available with the examination center. They keep so many varieties of drugs which causes uterine relaxation. Now you must again know the side effects, the complications, the dosage that is being used, the route that is used. So that is very important, especially with all these drugs, because use of excessive drugs are going to cause problems, which in a pregnant patient is going to be very, very harmful. Now, the magnesium sulfate to control the convulsion, the diazepam, the dilantin sodium, and also calcium gluconate as an antidote to magnesium sulfate therapy is kept. So I have grouped them according to the action so that one can be easy to remember what are the drugs that are being kept. Then ovulation inducing drugs are kept. Clomiphene, HMG, HCG, the various preparations are there on the table. Progesterons, and the progesterons of so many varieties now that are being used. But let me tell you, please don't give answers which are not reasonable. I have seen people telling normal pregnancy may be progesterone supplement karte hain. Abortions, threatened abortions may be supplement karte hain. Habitual abortions may be dete hain. So you should be able to convince why you are giving that drug, in how much dosage, for how long you want to give. You should be logical in your answers and you should be able to convince the examiner why you are giving it. That is very, very important. Now, gynae instruments. In gynae instruments, Cusco speculum is given, Sim speculum is given, and anterior vaginal wall retractor is kept. You must know, see, there are people who pick up a Sim speculum They don't pick up an anterior vaginal wall retractor. They don't know that anterior vaginal retractor is there. And those people who pick up the anterior vaginal wall retractor say it as a uterine curette. Now, they say we curette the postpartum uterus and all. See, anterior vaginal wall retractor is used to retract the anterior vaginal wall to see the cervix. You must know the advantage of Cusco speculum and Sim speculum with the anterior vaginal wall retractor. Where you will use Sim speculum with anterior vaginal wall retractor, the advantage, the disadvantage, same with the Cusco speculum, where you will use it, what is the advantage, what are the disadvantages, one should be able to say it. Now, if you don't say that, in our hospital we use it. Anterior vaginal wall retractor is not commonly used as a uterine curette and all, even in the postpartum uterus. So please don't give answers which are not right. Now, uterine sound is shown. Now, when the uterine sound is shown, the question is asked, what is the normal length of the uterus? Now, what are the conditions where the normal the length is increased? So you have to be able to say it. Now, in gynecological situations, how do you use the sound? Why is it important to sound the uterus? Now, in this connection, though it is not related here, I will tell a common mistake that is usually being made. Uterine prolapse, they say the management is vaginal hysterectomy with vaginal hysterectomy. Of course, vaginal hysterectomy is not the treatment for prolapse. You have to do, along with it, pelvic wall repair. You are asked, what is the step that cures the cystocele? The steps used for what? So the anatomy also, it here comes. How is the vaginal wall related? Posterior, anterior vaginal wall related? Posterior vaginal wall related? So you should be able to answer that. People may answer everything. Suddenly you go to anatomy, posterior vaginal wall. They cannot answer. They don't know how much is related to pouch of Douglas, rectum, and the perineum. So, and how, when you dissect, how do you know that you haven't reached the rectum? So, these are practical questions which are asked, because if you are going to do surgery, you should be knowing these small points and you should be able to say. Now, alternative to surgery, everybody says sling operation. You ask, what is the criteria? How will you pick up a patient for sling operation? They are stuck. They don't know when to do a sling operation. Everybody knows sling operation, but when to do it, nobody knows. So you should be able to tell exactly in which case you will do sling operation, in which case you will do only amputation, which case you will do Manchester with sterilization, vaginal hysterectomy with repair. So all these, you should be very clear in your mind when we are going to do this. Because either you get prolapse, start with uterine sound, or it prolapse is given as a short case, and in all that it is going to come. Then endometrial biopsy curette, the Rubin's cannula. People forget now that the endometrial biopsy curette is also used to determine what type of material you get, secretory endometrium or proliferative endometrium, whether there is any tuberculosis associated with it. So people are doing investigations but never do a endometrial biopsy. People forget. So you please remember that endometrial biopsy is still done and it is being used. Now I'm saying this for institutions where infertility treatment are done, people usual procedures, they go for straight away for ovulation study with ultrasound and all, never telling that this is also one of the methods which also gives you additional information, because our country has got tuberculosis. Tuberculosis has got to be ruled out. Now, IS spatula is shown, cytobrush, and punch biopsy fossils. Now you know IS spatula and cytobrush is used for cytology, screening tests, and then sponge biopsy forceps. Different types of cervical biopsies are asked. When will you do a punch biopsy? What is the advantage and disadvantage? when will you do a wedge biopsy, when will you do a cone biopsy. So it is very important to do that. Then they asked about the operation itself. They show you the instrument and or they tell, okay, pick up the instruments required for an endometrial biopsy. Pick up the instruments that are needed for a dilatation of the cervix. Pick up for DNC. So you should be able to pick up. This is one way of knowing whether you know all the instruments that are to be needed. You have to tell your sister. If you are having an independent practice, you should be able to tell your sister what is it required in one go. So you are asked to pick up the instrument. Then we are asked how you sound the uterus. Then cervical biopsy, as I already told you, punch biopsy, wedge biopsy, then large loop excision biopsy, cone biopsy. Cone biopsy, what is the difference between cold knife, laser, using cautery knife, the various type of conization procedures. Why you don't do a cautery conization every time with a cautery knife? Why don't it remove the tissue? So all these questions require a logical answer. You should be able to tell where you will do a cold knife conization, where you will use a cautery knife, because laser cautery is not available everywhere. Tubal patency test, the different test, hysterosalpingogram, diagnostic laparoscopy and chromotubation, sonosalpingography, the dye used, all that you should be able to tell. Then the cervical cautery, electric, cryo, laser, the follow-up of the after the cautery, when will you call the patient, when will you do it, what instruction will you give it to your patient. So every operation you must be able to answer all these things, because these are the common operations performed. Now sometimes, now if you, I never ask or fail a student because they couldn't answer on so many other things. Minimum is this. If there are kept laparoscopic instruments, varice needle, trocar and cannula, instruments for surgery, laparoscopic surgery are kept. Hysteroscopy, the hysteroscope instruments for hysteroscopic surgery, microsurgical instruments for tubal recanalization, colposcopy, the directed biopsy, cryocautery instruments. Now if students are not able to answer, I don't hold it against them, because every institution may not be using all the instruments. So I tell them, if you haven't used it, leave it, pick up something which you can do. So common instruments everybody should know. The special instrument, if you are know about it, you say, in my institution this is not being used. We don't insist on you answering that. Say, pick up common instrument and we will ask you on that. So you will be asked on common gynecological operations that are being done. Now specimens. Now both the gynae table, obstetric table, even on the spotting, specimens are kept. Now the specimen has resulted from which operation? Why do you say so? If I say bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, hysterectomy with bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy, you should be able to say that I see both the ovaries and the tube in the specimen. So I say this operation has been done. What is the diagnosis? Can you tell out from the specimen? Now what will be the clinical picture the patient would have presented with? Now the other questions that are asked is, what are the other symptoms that can be produced by fibroid? Now what are the complications caused by these fibroids? What is the alternative surgery for it? So any, like ovarian tumor, fibroids, whatever it is, ectopic pregnancy. So what are the alternative surgery? What are the complications that are produced at each time? So the clinical picture of that particular specimen and the disease causing other symptoms also, other surgery that is possible also, all these questions arise from this. Now on public health. You are asked questions on public health because it is very important that each candidate knows what is going in your country. Now maternal mortality, the causes and measures to reduce it. So many things are being done in the RCH2 to reduce the maternal mortality. So you should know the causes at least. people are unable to tell 5 causes of maternal deaths in our country. That's a very sad situation. It should not happen. So maternal deaths, the perinatal mortality, the causes and measures to reduce it. Now demography and family planning is linked. So demography related to family planning. Sometimes the examiners ask that questions. Now RTI, STI, the syndromic management, the various measures that are being adopted to prevent HIV/AIDS, the awareness programs that are being done in the country. So RTI, STI, the syndromic management, why the syndromic management is good, why it is not good, how you can improve it. So your opinion also should come. So your institutional opinion, your teacher's opinion will matter. You should ask her why syndromic management is important. What are the disadvantage, advantage? You can ask her that and learn the answers from them. HIV/AIDS, then the RCH2, there is something called a National Rural Health Mission. ASHA, accredited social health activist. So these people are there to improve the maternal child health and the related issues. So you must know something about these things. You cannot just ignore it. As a specialist in obstetrics and gynecology, you are being trained and you should know what is currently happening around you. Details nobody will ask. You should know what is envisaged in this program and how they are going about it, the government is going about it. You should know that much. Now the spots are kept. Now I am giving you a list of spots. There are usually 10 spots. The last slide, Chitra?
Yes, spots. This is the last slide.
Spots.
I kept it. Spots.
It doesn't come.
It will come.
It doesn't come in the screen. Spots. Usually 10 spots are kept and 20 marks are there. 10 marks are allotted to the obstetric viva and 10 marks are allotted to the gynae viva. Usually it goes half-half, we divide. It is not that how many are kept and how many. Amongst the instruments, 1 to 2 instruments are kept. X-ray, either gynae or obstetric X-ray will be there. That also 1 to 2. Drugs are kept, 1 to 2. Partograph, 1. You are asked to interpret. Cardiotopograph, 1. Ultrasound picture, 1. Specimen, 1 to 2. Slide, 1. So I have given you 8. They keep 10 spots. So 1 or 2 will be 2. And in each spot, the questions are asked 1 or 2. This is one place where you can score a lot of marks. 18 to 20 marks. This is like maths, the sums. Do correctly, you get the full mark. Nobody detect. Wherever there is a little deficiency, people make up by these. So you should be very clear. Very spot means just the question and answer. There are 2 questions, sometimes 3 questions are asked, the small questions. 1 sentence, 2 sentences. So if you are good in your spots, you can score a lot of marks. And I don't know how much time is left to speak.
It's almost over.
So I think if you have any difficulty, you can ask me. I have tried to cover all topics. From anything of these, you can ask any questions. But usually, the common questions are asked, not very complicated. They are not asked.
I can only add emergency contraception, which
yes, in the pills
you covered everything completely from in all aspects. And I think, as madam has already said, that it is like maths. You can compensate for your long case and short cases where you don't get that much.
20 marks for spots. See, ward round carries 40 marks. The obstetric viva and gynae viva constitutes 30 marks each. And out of these 30 marks, 10 marks are given to the spots for each. So 20 marks in the viva voci. But let me tell you, the viva voci carries a lot of importance, because if you are doing very well, you can score a lot of marks.
Yeah. But if you don't do well in demi-doll and pelvis, you can you can pass also.
It is very important.
Very basic.
Because we are testing your knowledge on various things, like breech delivery, the cesarean section, how to deliver a breech, how to deliver a transverse leg, which cannot be asked in the cases. So your overall knowledge is tested with any presentation, any position, any type of delivery. So the knowledge is tested here. Whether you have
score at the same time, you can slide also in this. So okay. It is very important. You will score
I
nicely.
Think we have covered the exam in toto. Thank you for attending. Any queries, you can fax them. We will try to answer them at a later date. Best of luck for your examinations. And thank you once again. Thank you all my experts for expressing so nicely the details of the examinations. Thank you.